Greetings, science fiction and fantasy enthusiasts. Do you read books? Do you watch films? Do you hate deodorant? Then welcome to our podcast. With Ryan Sean O'Reilly, David Wilkinson, and Richard Mell. You're listening to No Deodorant in Outer Space. Now, let's get started.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, and welcome to another edition of No Deodorant in Outer Space. With me on this episode is the malevolent David Wilkinson.
Hi.
and with him is the falsely accused Richard Mell.
Good morning, everybody.
And I am, of course, the benign and unaware Ryan Sean O'Reilly. And the three of us united, I don't know what united what we do. Something special, I'm sure. But aside from that, in this episode, we, of course, are going to be hunting witches as we review the book The Last Apprentice, Revenge of the Witch by Joseph Delaney, and the film Seventh Son, directed by Sergei Bodrov and starring Jeff Bridges. I think in England, this book is actually called The Spook's Apprentice, and the series is called The Wardstone Chronicles. Wilk, why don't you give us your opening thoughts for this book?
I wish I had read this book 25 years ago, but it wasn't written then. It was all right, I guess. It's written for a younger audience, but it was interesting nonetheless. And it had occultism, Satanism, witches, yeah. I want to point out that every book in the series has the word spook in it, but they somehow remove that word from the American version.
Well, right, obviously.
And the movie. I don't think the word is that bad.
I guess it just didn't occur to me until right now why they removed it. I mean, right when you said that, Ryan, it never occurred to me until then.
Yeah, well, I think it's got negative connotations in this country.
Of course it does. I
mean, you know what's funny? You guys ever heard of the book The Human Stain? It was made into a movie, but it's about a professor who says, wow, there's a bunch of spooks in here, because he's referring to what he thinks might be ghosts or something like that. And a few black kids in the class get offended, and he ends up getting fired from his job. And then it turns out later that the professor is black himself, but he has a weird pigmentation. It's by Roth. And I don't know, it's all about the context of certain words and how they evolve over time, amongst other things. But I never thought of the word spook as having a negative connotation, really. I guess some people use it that way, but it seems like it's an old-timey racist word.
Yeah, it is. But I guess the publishers must have felt probably don't want to put it on the covers of their books if they're going to try to sell them.
Yeah, but it's just funny, too, that Roth is one of the most accomplished and respected writers in the world, and he made a whole book about the misuse of this word. And
what is he, kind of like a linguist, or what does he write about?
He writes, it's Philip Roth. He wrote the, what is that first book he wrote? Portnoy's Complaint, which is probably one of my favorite. He's on the list of, like, best books of the 21st century or 20th century. He's got like five of them on there.
Oh, cool. I'll have to check them out.
Yeah. Read Portnoy's Complaint. It's the whole thing. It's like, it's basically like a young Howard Stern. It's about a Jewish kid growing up in New York and his sexual misadventures. At one point, he has intercourse with the family's dinner before it's served. I mean,
wow.
It's American Pie completely. Well, okay. I'm using American,
more American Pie.
Oh, let's keep it PG-13.
This is PG-13. American Pie was PG-13, Ryan.
Intercourse with dinner.
Ryan,
wake up. Hello, America.
Oh, come on. Jeez,
my point is that
Mr.
American
Rogers
Pie...
Mr. Rogers over here.
This guy's won the Pulitzer Prize. He's won awards for almost every... I mean, Google Philip Roth. I mean, he's probably one of the most accomplished writers living right now, and he's in his 80s. But I'm just saying, some of the concepts he did there, I mean, you can see are heavily borrowed on by Howard Stern, by some of the more body movies, are taken from this Portnoy's Complaint, which is just a hilarious, laugh-out-loud book. The whole book is about him talking to a psychiatrist. That's the whole book, about his various fears and sexual proclivities and things like that. It was written in the 60s, and I think it was his first book. But anyways, he has a whole book, which kind of goes into how the use of the word spook in one situation, taken out of context, destroyed a person's life when, I don't know. It's what I'm saying is a complete non sequitur, which you probably move on. But yeah, So that's the only reason I know the word spook. I've never heard the word spook been used in a negative context, except in the book The Human Stain, and the point there was,
well, I think you're right. I think
kind
it's
of ironic.
It's an old term.
Yeah, it's old. But I'm glad we got to delve into that because Joseph Delaney's bio is pretty short and sweet. I guess he never went to a formal college.
Oh, wait, are you trying to start the bio now?
Yeah, I am.
Well, let's just get your opening remark. We haven't done that yet.
Oh, about the book?
Yeah, the opening remark for the show we do every show.
Right. I'm going to just say that this is a book that would probably be great for me in a couple of years when my oldest son is 7 years old and we get to kind of read a children's book. Right now, kind of more inconvenient for an adult to read. They should enjoy it with a kid, basically.
Okay. And I'll say that I felt this was a heroic fantasy blending in just the right amount of horror for young readers to delight in. So I enjoyed it. Then let's go to the bio. The bio is, of course, about the author, Joseph Delaney. Rick, what do you got for us?
Yes, Joseph Delaney, he was an engineer's apprentice, and, well, he liked J.R.R. Tolkien, and he had kind of like a rough youth, according to him. He got into a lot of fights. He was in a band, and he started writing, and this was after he changed his career. He went from a pipe fitter engineer to a
teacher, right? Yeah.
Teacher in media studies.
I think he wasn't a media teacher at first, right? And then he,
I don't know what kind of teacher he was at first, but he was kind of like a media media studies teacher.
He said for the first 15 years of teaching he hated it. And then he founded a film and media studies program at some college.
Right.
And then he actually loved the job.
Mhm.
And then, yeah. But then he got success with writing, so he quit.
Right. And he started writing, you know, adult fiction, I guess. But then his agent convinced him that he should be writing young adult fiction or children's fiction. I think it's more along the lines of children's fiction. I would not consider the Spook's Apprentice young adult adults at all.
It's, I think this is considered technically young adult. I think children's fiction is like good.
It might be considered young adult for the United States, but not for Britain.
Well, for marketing purposes, I think children's books is like Goodnight Moon and like that level.
Can we just jump on something here about Britain? I feel like their literature, their storytelling just so exceeds the way people tell stories in the United States. And like, I mean, like, yeah, you're right. This isn't quite young adult, but it's really sophisticated writing for young children compared to other series of serial young adult novels that I've read. I love the British. I mean, yeah, I mean, I read this in the night. It was a good read. It wasn't that complicated, but I mean, their storytelling ability, it's just ingrained in their culture. Almost every good storyteller, I feel, for young adults comes from Great Britain.
Yeah, I agree. It's very distinguished over there. They take a lot of pride in what they do. You know, they think they're the best, and I think they are the best. Especially now reading our next book, the contrast is just, oh my God.
Well, let's not get into the next book.
Oh my God. I won't.
Let's cut down the non sequiturs.
Yeah. We don't have all day.
Oh my God. Let's just skip that one.
Okay.
Anyway, yeah. So I think Joseph Delaney enjoyed the Dune series too, which kind of made me go off on a tangent a couple weeks ago and do a lot of research on Dune, made me wish that we were covering Dune maybe this year, but yeah, maybe we can do it as a bonus episode. I don't know. But what else? He's Joseph Delaney prides himself immensely on his work ethic, and it's one of the things he shares with a lot of other, you know, prolific authors. Writing block is not a thing. He just works through it. It's just part of the job. With that, that's pretty much all I have to say about Joseph Delaney. It's pretty short and sweet.
Did you see that he originally wrote under a pseudonym, J.K. Hederach?
Yeah, and he wasn't right. He wasn't very.
Some of those tales
successful with that
were interesting titles. One was called Mercer's Horror, and the other was a short story called Elvira Should Be Easy, which is part of Mysterious Erotic Tales. So I don't know. I don't know what he was writing.
Those to me, I mean, they don't.
I think he was still writing fantasy, though, I think, as the adult stuff, but for whatever reason, it didn't work out. And I know I saw that he...
Yeah, those titles really don't stick in my head, so...
I know that he didn't consider himself a retired teacher. He just said he just kind of quit teaching to go write books.
Well, he's got that age complex thing now. If you're consider retired, then, you know, people will assume that you're too old to do something.
And you know, he lives in Lancashire, which where these books are based. And I think he indicated like a lot of that countryside is directly inspired him to write the series. He claims that there are Bogarts around that countryside, and some of the landmarks around him have made their way into the book. He's changed the names of some of the places. But I think one of the scenes in the book, or it, well, probably not just one, but at least one, was directly inspired from his childhood, where him and his siblings all had a reoccurring dream or something, or experience, that involved ghosts. And so that was one of the scenes of the book.
Yeah, if you want to get into that, I mean, what's the name of the county that
Lancashire.
That he's from? That the setting of the Lincolnshire, right?
Yeah.
So, and that's in Northern Ireland, or is that Northern
I thought
England?
It was in England.
Okay.
Okay, let's move on.
So, yeah. Okay, Will, do you have anything to add?
Oh, no, I meant from the county. No, I've got lots to add.
Oh, okay,
That's all.
Yeah, go ahead and anything you have to add about the bio.
No, the bio, I think you got covered.
If we're done with the bio, then let's just do a quick synopsis of the book. Will, why don't you give us a quick synopsis?
Oh, it's early. Okay.
Remember to include character names so we have some kind of reference to what's going on.
I honestly, that's not how my mind works.
I know, but I keep telling you, you could just write down.
I know you do. I know. I didn't write a review out. The quick synopsis of the book. Well, it starts on a small farm in the county that we just discussed, where a character whose name I'm completely blanking on.
Isn't it
Tom Ward?
Is the seventh son of a seventh son, Tom Ward. Tom Ward is being told, you know, he's going off with what is the spook. Because he, there's no, that work for him at the farm. And his dad is the seventh son of his family, and Tom is the seventh son of his family, and that makes him very valuable to the spook, and that was the intent of his mom the whole time, and she wanted him to go off with said spook, and he kind of hits the ground running. The spook's job is basically to wander the earth and take care of evil, and it's kind of a pretty badass concept that I was really into, and I kept thinking to myself, what a cool idea for a story. And they have travels, they wander, they find a witch, they take care of said witch, and the devil makes an appearance. It's probably the worst summary I've done. But like I said, it's a quick read. I really didn't put the book down. I picked it up, and I'm like, oh, I mean, I think I did this in one night in about 3.5 or 5 hours. I read it about 2 a.m. after the kids went to bed, and it reminded me of the kind of thing that you would tell around a campfire. I mean, it was very, everything kind of flowed. They kind of left some doors open for other books in the series, of which there are many. There was a character, is it Anna?
Alice.
Yeah. Jesus, okay. Who you're not sure if she's quite good or quite evil, but in the end, she kind of helps out. The spook, I loved the character, and I liked him in the movie as well, too. Just kind of this gruff, overbearing gentleman who's very open about how, well, many of his apprentices have died in the past, and yeah, it's kind of an interesting developing relationship, but it's more of a wandering journey, first in a series, but it doesn't really belabor a lot of points, and I didn't stop turning the pages the whole time.
Yeah, it's definitely a quick read.
I honestly wasn't paying that much attention when I read it. I was just reading it, if that makes sense. It was kind of like the equivalent of watching a TV show that you're half paying attention to. I liked it, but I wasn't hanging on every word.
Well, so what do you guys think about the beginning of the book and the premise, which is it's a 12-year-old farm boy who's going off on adventure? So that's probably a very, very classic fantasy trope. To have like someone, some kind of simple country person is going to go off and change the world. And that's been done a lot of times. But I mean, I felt it worked here. Did you guys have any thoughts about that, about his like quote unquote humble beginnings? Rick?
I love it. I think that formula works every time, just as long as you can write it. It invests you into the character, and you gain that empathy for the character. Once you get introduced to such a humble background, you pull for the character. Even if the character makes a stupid decision, you're still pulling for the character. So you're with him through thick and thin, and he does make poor decisions through the book, but yeah, it doesn't matter. You know that he's only 12 years old, going on 13, and he's learning. He's an apprentice. So
what about you, Wilk? Did you feel it was okay, I've seen this before, blah blah blah, let's move on, or you felt like it worked?
Oh, I felt like it worked completely. I mean, the story, it didn't, you know, blow my hair back, but I mean, it was a well-written story. I mean, it had some, it wasn't completely derivative or reductive of other things.
Yeah, I think I agree with you guys. Even though I've seen this before, it worked, and it wasn't, that aspect of it wasn't necessarily original, but he does move into original territory when he follows the spook, who is, you know, this sort of witch finder, ghost hunter kind of guy. And so let's move on to that aspect. And I found very interesting in these books is the spook is hunting not just witches, but he's also hunting, Bogarts, ghosts, ghasts, and witches. And the author does a really good explanation of these different beings that they're, you know, looking out for, seeking out to, you know, calm down or, you know, eliminate from causing harm to people. And he really sets up like sort of like a system and categorization. And the main character is an apprentice, hence the name of the book. And he's learning these things and the spook is telling him to write them down. And it kind of almost... it seemed like really ripe to become like a video game or like a card game or something, the way that the author was laying out these classifications. I don't know. I really enjoyed that, learning about the different types of creatures and stuff and how they could be expected to behave and things like that. Wilk, what did you think about that aspect of it?
I'm not really sure.
No thoughts. Rick, what about you?
I got a thought. These contrived rules, they seem to be kind of like all the craze now with Harry Potter. I mean, there's a whole world of wizardry out there now, and, you know, you quantify a wizard's ability to, you know, cast any kind of spell or what's needed and all that. Now, Joseph Delaney kind of created...
That's been going on for longer than Harry Potter.
Well, I mean, Harry Potter...
I mean, look at Dungeons & Dragons.
Dungeons & Dragons, I mean, that's not a book. Yeah. I mean, that's a game, well, and it's supposed to be quantified. And these books for young adults, they just... It seems like Harry Potter just sort of brought it all into this book context. And Joseph Delaney, not that he's just a copycat, but he's done that with the Spook's Apprentice. And I really don't really care about all these conventions and stuff. It's pretty cool if you're into it as a, you know, as an adolescent. But I mean, in the back of the book, there's a whole sort of cookbook on how to be a spook, and you know, it's kind of cool if you want to get into it. You know,
caters to the audience, I think.
Right.
I also felt like it was a good way to flesh out the world more, you know, and make it more real. I mean, it's a good world building tool, I felt.
Right.
So going on that, there is a particular Bogart. In this book, the spook has a two houses, I guess. He has a winter home and a summer home. And they go to the one, and there is apparently a Bogart living there who sort of keeps house for the spook. And he or she are invisible, and then they take, like, the form of a cat. It's an interesting character because the Bogart, it's even though it's the spook's, like, friend keeping his house, it also can be mean. And when they go there, there is rules and stuff. And the spook tells Tom Ward, "Hey, breakfast is going to be made for us in the morning, but don't go down early. You know, only go when breakfast is ready, and you'll hear this dinner bell." And Tom has this kind of funny scene where he's not sure if he heard it or not. So he goes down there and he sees like all these preparations for food, and then like mid preparation, and then I think doesn't he get like knocked upside the head by an unseen force, which is basically the Bogart?
I don't know, but I think that kind of speaks to... It's kind of an odd thing about this book. It almost takes you back to, you know, old Salem, Massachusetts, because there is a bias against women in this book, okay? And there are witches in this book, and the spook, Gregory, he doesn't really have many good things to say about women when he's teaching Tom. And, you know, lo and behold, his companion...
He's very leery.
Yeah.
He's leery of women.
His companion in his own home is not even a female. It's a Bogart who makes him breakfast and stuff like that. So he's, you know, at the time he's celibate, we find out later that, yeah, he's had relationships and stuff like that, but they've all gone kind of sour.
But he does consult Tom's mother for advice. And he respects
right.
her opinion.
Yeah.
He's more than once going to her and kind of getting her take on things. And I think it's alluded that she has some kind of powers going on with her. And I don't think they spell it out in the first book.
No, it's not made entirely clear, but I mean, it is kind of, because you do realize through the spook's teachings to Tom that there are different types of witches. There are benevolent types, and then there are malevolent types.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. But so that's like kind of a counter to the Bogarts, or the Spooks sort of being leery of women. He does have that other side where he does go consult to Tom's mother.
But it's kind of refreshing that this kind of comes up in today's day and age, because women are in fact, in reality, they're unpredictable. They're mystic. You know, I still don't know. You know, I've never ventured to look into the soul of my own wife. I mean, it's just like I don't even want to go there. It's like,
Rick, you,
I was just thinking. I've been quiet for a while, and now I have like nothing. Now I'm gonna be quiet for even longer. I'm not even sure what to say. So,
well, Rick, you grew up with.
I've never had sisters.
You never had sisters,
yeah,
okay. And you don't have any daughters. And Wilk, you're the opposite. You only have daughters.
I have three, yes. And
you had sisters growing
two
up.
Two sisters. These early morning podcasts. I do not like this format. I'm just sitting here staring into space. What was the question?
Well, we're talking about, I guess, the feminist aspect of the book is the spook is leery of women. But and I guess all the main antagonists are females.
Well, okay, but
although they're all witches, he's dealing with them.
But there's a broader context with that. The spook is wary of really anything that's not dead and trying to kill him. I mean, he doesn't really have a good relationship with anyone, and most of his apprentices die. So there's
he's a hermit, basically.
But it's a classic archetype where you have a character who doesn't want to get close to people because whoever gets close to dies. And that's a theme that we see throughout literature. So I mean, I don't think it's a problem with a woman. I think it's a problem with everyone, which brings the line, a great Clint Eastwood line that I can't repeat from the movie Alcatraz, where he, I'm not going to say the line, but a guy asks him, do you have a problem with this group? And Clint Eastwood, you can't get into it, never mind. Okay.
So I mean, that's a very good point, though, and you do hear all these comments that people don't like the spook, and they want his services, but then they want him to go away, because they think he's weird in what he does. And that actually comes up for the protagonist, Tom Ward, because he's living at home, he's a young kid, and he goes off, and when he comes back for a visit, his home has changed, and he has all these siblings, but we only really meet one, his older brother, who's married, and now has to take over the farm, because Tom's dad is getting too old, and they have a sort of strained relationship then, and it becomes more strained when he comes home, and now Tom is like this officially the spook's apprentice, and he has this kind of standoff relationship with him. But Rick, what did you think about the relationship with the brother and how it evolves? And do you feel like, because the brother basically is like, yeah, you're my brother, come home, but really we kind of don't want you here.
Yeah, his brother's a snob. He's entitled to the property that his father has developed over the years because he's the firstborn, and his brother is married, he's starting to have children, and he's coming kind of like a crotchety old man right before Tom's eyes. And Tom, it's hard to deal with, and it's one of the reasons why Tom's mother sends him off with a spook, because that's just sort of the natural progression of the farming family, is that the firstborn keeps the house, the other boys, they need to go off and find trades to work in, and Tom's the last one. This is the trade he happens to fall into. Well, not just happens. He's the seventh son of a seventh son, right?
But the brother also has legitimate reasons, because he's got a new kid and he's got to protect his family. And he feels that when Tom comes home, he's bringing evil stuff with him. And
yeah, but he doesn't really handle that role with a whole lot of grace. He's not a gentleman about it. He's like I said, he's becoming more crotchety and advanced even for his own age.
What did you think of the character Alice? I know you couldn't remember her name, but she's probably the most interesting character in the book.
She is. I love characters like that where it's kind of ambiguous. I
explain her a little bit. Explain her a little.
I don't know. It's a kid's book, man. What do you want me to do? She's
Well, okay, so basically Tom goes to stay with the spook, and the spook tells him, go to town and run some errands for me, but whatever you do, don't talk to any women with pointy shoes. Just to summarize it.
It's good advice.
On his way home, he's kind of heckled by these town tough kids, and this strange girl comes out of the forest and tells them off by threatening them that her aunt is going to will be mad at them. And so she kind of does a favor for Tom and then has like an expectation that he will do a favor for her in return. And
yeah, I don't know. Well, yeah. Well, no, okay, fine. Yeah. That's a summary. Yes. That's, the thing with Alice like that, I kept trying to figure out if it was a long con, like if she was setting him up to trust him so she could take advantage of him later. Like for the minute, just the way that she was written, I'm like, I thought it was kind of ambiguous whether you could believe that she was trying to help him or it was a trick. And so at the end, she definitely proved to be loyal to him. The spook doesn't like her because she's essentially got witch blood or whatever you want to call it, which again brought back a whole lot of other thoughts and themes involving other books and societal trends. But yeah, no, I think overall, I mean, she's a conflicted Han Solo type character, only the Han Solo. I mean, she's not quite good, she's not quite bad, and she is the most interesting because she's not, you don't know where she stands completely. You don't know where she's going to go.
I feel like even at the end, you feel like she's done the right, but you still have a kind of a question. I thought the author did a really great job of describing her.
Do you guys ever see The Fox and the Hound?
I never have.
Cartoon?
No.
Oh, it's
okay.
Old animated?
Yeah.
Disney
movie?
Well,
I mean, basically, in The Fox and the Hound, the fox saves the hound from being killed by a bear after the hound is helping his master hunt the fox in the woods. But the whole point is these two animals were friends when they were kids. And after the fox saves the hound, they kind of look at each other and the hound goes away. And the understanding is, based on our natures, we can't be friends. I have to help destroy you. And I kind of get that vibe from Alice. I'm like, I wonder what's going to happen throughout the rest of the series. Even though she likes him, she's a fox, he's a hound, or vice versa. And, you know, one has to hunt the other. And that's almost the exact setup of this book. I mean, he's supposed to hunt people like her down.
Yeah.
But again, it's a great element for a story like this. And again, my oldest is 11, and I've been trying to, you know, and she's at that age, if I recommend something to her, she's like, I don't want her to read this book and see if she likes it. So I've been like leaving it out, like, hey, check it out, because I think she's the perfect age to really appreciate this kind of stuff. And it is appropriately dark. I don't know. I love the British.
Yeah. Well, let's get into that. The darkness of this. Rick, this story, it's for young adults or whatever, grade school, mid-level for children. But it does get dark, and there is monsters and stuff, and there is some bad things that happen. I mean, you have, like, people's blood being used to make food and things like that. And how did you feel about the level of, I guess, horror, for lack of a better term, in this writing?
Well, you kind of need that to have that sense of fear and horror in the reader. So you're led to believe that the witch gets all of her power from, well, she does, the malevolent witch, she gets her powers from young blood, okay, especially baby's blood. And in the beginning of the book, a couple of toddlers and a baby goes missing, and Tom starts to believe that the cakes that Alice had given him in the beginning to feed the witch who was incarcerated in a pit was some of the flesh and blood of a missing baby. And Tom realizes that's what he fed this witch, and he feels bad about it. But then he later learns that it was only Alice's blood, and the baby was returned, and the toddler showed up again.
But how did you feel about that? I mean, it's not really a graphic.
Do you think it was like out of bounds? No, I don't think it was out of bounds.
Okay. It's not a graphic book,
no.
But it does get kind of dark.
It gets dark, but, you know, so does all of these types of books nowadays. It's just, that's... And even Sleepy Hollow, that short cartoon from Disney, I mean, that was pretty dark, too. I mean, it was...
Grimm Fairy Tales, if I can address the whole getting dark kind of thing, I think we as Americans are kind of wusses about that, because if you look at all the European fiction aimed at young adults, it was designed to scare the pants out of people from hundreds of years ago.
Right.
The original Grimm Fairy Tales. And even, you guys probably read Roald Dahl when you were growing up.
No.
Maybe you're reading it to your kids now.
No, I've read Grimm, but...
Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a book called The Witch.
Oh, he wrote... What did he write? Charlie and the Chocolate Factory?
Yeah, the Big Friendly Giant. Okay. He wrote... We should definitely read him then if you haven't. He's fantastic. He's written dozens of books. Most of them Matilda was made into a movie. That was a kid's book. It involved a kid.
Yeah.
It's basically like a kid's version of Stephen King's Carrie, but it came out before Carrie. But it's the exact same premise.
Yeah.
He wrote a book called The Witches, which is terrifying, and it doesn't have a happy ending, and it's designed for kids.
Yeah, there are implicit dark concepts, but they're never sort of brought out into detail, you know, for the kids' sake. But the concepts are all there.
Wilk, did you think it was you thought it was the right amount, basically?
I did, and again, I mean, I encourage people, and I did myself. I read books that were pretty overtly adult at a pretty young age. I mean, I don't think this was, it didn't have any of the sexual tropes or profanity that a Stephen King book would have, but it had some of the same themes, which I think is appropriate. I mean, you can be dark without ruining someone's innocence, so to speak. And I don't think these concepts are anti-kid. I just think we get into this whole soccer mom nanny state sometimes.
Oh, God,
where it's like, yeah, I mean, so I don't think this was too dark for kids.
Yeah, I felt like I felt it was just the right amount. It's interesting, though, some of the issues that come up, like the what do they do with the witches? And I think the spook says there's only really two ways to eliminate them. You have to either burn them or eat their heart. And the spook actually is like, he takes the real, you know, the story starts with this really bad witch, Mother Malkin, who's like the main antagonist, who is stuck in a pit with bars over the top. And she's like basically just imprisoned there, which is, you know, and they point out that it's a pretty cruel thing. But yet the alternative, I guess, is to burn her. They kind of toy around with, well, what can we do here? But I think the spook explains that he does that, imprison them, because he feels like if they try to kill her, then she'll be reborn and she'll have even more powers or something like that.
But the spook also has a soft side, you know, he feels that, you know, death by burning or eating the heart is just way too ruthless, even for someone in his position, and he just does not recommend it. It is an option, but he never goes there just because it's inhumane, according to him, which is nice and refreshing, you know. Yeah. And then, you know, as the story progresses, Tom starts to learn, you know, especially from Alice, who is his sort of like counterpart, that, you know, sometimes you just got to like do the right thing. Just kill the witch, you know, eat her heart, burn her, you know, do the right thing, because she will always be there if you don't do that.
Yeah. Alice is such an interesting character, and where she's coming from, being raised by the evil witches and yet having this side where she's just very interesting. It's like you said, Wilk, it's a very great element for a story, and I think, you know, she continues throughout the series, I'm sure. So I think that wraps up the book. I don't anyone have any final comments, or that's pretty much it, right?
I think
okay, then we can move on to the movie Seventh Son, which was directed by Sergei Bodrov. Wilk, what can you tell us about him, the director?
You know, I did some research on him, and I'm not gonna do any silly jokes, but I did the precursory Wikipedia research. I found some interviews and articles, but there is not a whole lot out there, and there I could find, but I found two really significant things about him. One isn't really about him, but it's about he had a son who's an actor who died tragically, and a lot of the searching comes up about that, and I feel bad for him, but he's only made four real major films, this being one of them. He's married to someone who works in the industry, which I think is how he got this film, because this movie was in development hell. But here is the really interesting part about him. He's Russian, and he made a movie about Genghis Khan, and that
Mongol.
Was...
It's called Mongol.
What's that? Mongol, yeah. Which I'm going to try and watch if I ever have time, because apparently, I didn't know this, Genghis Khan is despised, the Mongols are despised in Russia, because I guess they did some horrible things to the Russian, which I was vaguely aware of, but it was very controversial and not well received that a Russian was making a movie about him that wasn't like, you know, basically a snuff film. And he thought, well, it's part of our history, we should make it, and that raised some eyebrows. And I love people who do things like that.
Eyebrows would that raise if you were to put down...
The Russians.
No, the Russians, they
consumers. Were... From a consumer standpoint.
Just general consumers. Not the Chinese or anything like that.
No, just because it wouldn't... Like, he made a... I mean, a lot of these movies in Russia, they get their funding, a lot in Europe too, from the state. I mean, there's a lot of programs set up where, because they don't have the same industry that we have here, where they get state funding to make these movies. And he couldn't get it because of the topic there. So it was truly an independently source film in Russia, because there wasn't people didn't think there'd be a lot of crowd demand to see a movie that was so unpopular. I mean, I guess it'd be like trying to make a movie about George Bush here that glorified him or something like that. I mean, I'm trying to think of...
Yeah, I read that another one of the reasons why he made that, I think, is his mother is Buryat. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but that's an indigenous people of Siberia. And they share customs and traditions that the Mongols also had. And so he, I think, felt some kinship to that.
Well, the Mongols got into the bloodline in Russia. I mean, that's for sure. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, I did see that too. But I think it kind of speaks to him and his character. And he's got kind of a avant-garde, you know, anti-authoritarian and bent about him. And it really wasn't reflected in the movie that he made here, which I don't think is his fault. He hasn't made a whole lot of movies, to be honest. But this movie itself, I thought, was interesting. It wasn't terribly directed, but it did seem like he did it as a favor, not as a passion. So,
well, wasn't he the third director?
Third or fourth, third known director. And again, the inside baseball is that his wife, who works in the industry, kind of put him up for this when they couldn't find somebody.
All right. I don't know if Rick, do you have anything to add about the director or no?
No, I don't.
Okay, then let's just, Rick, why don't you give us a quick synopsis of the movie and just, you know, how it was different than the book.
Okay, yeah, the scope of the movie was much more broad, made me believe that they incorporated some of other, you know, some of the other stories of Joseph Delaney, because some of the events in the movie just kind of went well beyond the scope of the book, which is fine. I was just sort of unprepared for that. I like the way that the movie started off. It started off with the original apprentice, who was played by the dude who plays Jon Snow in Game of Thrones. And
Kit Harington?
Yeah, and you were kind of led to believe that this was Tom Ward. And then, you know, after about 5 minutes, he gets burned and he's dead. And you're like, whoa, what the hell happened? So the apprentice goes off, and or the spook goes off and tries to find another apprentice. He finds Tom Ward. But Tom is older,
right?
Yes.
Tom's not a 12-year-old boy.
Tom is not 12. He's like a strapping 18-year-old with a chip on his shoulder, yeah, ready to go, you know, screw the world and screw everything else.
Screw?
And that's he's kind of like on a mission to do that. You know, as soon as he sees Alice, he doesn't get that forewarning from the spook. He just sort of runs into her in the streets of one of the nearby villages, and he automatically, you know, tries to seduce her. And it very quickly becomes a love story between Tom and Alice, the witch, which is a total sort of out of left field from the book. Because there's a little bit of uncomfortable attraction in the book, but nothing like this. I mean, they've got like a bed scene in the movie, and it's definitely a little bit more sultry in the movie. What else? There's just a whole lot more going on in the movie. There's a lot of action, a lot of CGI. There's more than just a couple of witches. There's a warlock. There's a couple of warlocks. There's like a shapeshifter. There's like a whole army of malevolent, you know, sorcerers in the movie that you don't learn about in the book, which makes, I think the movie needed that just to be marketable. Unfortunately, you know, when we saw that movie opening night, it was just DOA. I mean, there were like 5 people in the theater, and you know, I think the movie does deserve a little bit better than that. It was entertaining. I found it pretty enjoyable. Jeff Bridges did a tremendous job,
yeah,
with the spook. He turned the,
yeah,
spook, and he made him into a really eccentric and pretty funny. I mean, just some of the remarks he made in the movie just made me laugh.
It reminded me of his performance in True Grit, the remake of the John Wayne movie, if you saw that.
I didn't see that, no. But
that was good.
Oh, Bridges did a wonderful job. And if it wasn't for him, maybe, you know, I'd say the movie sucked. But no, the movie was pretty good.
Well, we did see it in the theater on opening night. Not a sneak preview or anything, but it's already been open in other countries.
Yeah.
And there was not a lot of people in the theater. One of the things that I noticed was that the spook in the book is a priest, actually. He used to be a priest. I don't know if he is anymore. In the movie, they made him a knight from some old order of the knights that's sworn to protect the world against evil and stuff.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, Rick, this made me think of your common complaint, like in like the I Am Legend movies,
yeah,
where they're always upgrading the character into some, you know, fancier,
oh, yeah,
background.
You know, the spook of the movie had a whole arsenal, and he lived in this, you know, knight's sort of barracks with, you know, crossbows. And I mean, yeah, the military aspect was just sort of, the bar was raised for the movie. And yeah, he was out to sort of wage war in this movie, whereas in the book it was just sort of like this one man operation. It still was a one man operation, but you just got the sense that there was this legacy of knighthood, and it was more about sort of honor and this blind faith in the order of knighthood that he was involved with.
It was really just like in I Am Legend when they upgraded the main character from like a worker to a scientist. And also in Something Wicked This Way Comes, they make the guy from a custodial worker to like the head librarian. they always have to do that. The other thing was that in this, and I don't know, I couldn't figure this out, but they made Mother Malkin, who's the chief antagonist, bad witch, an ex-lover of the spook. Well,
Hollywood, classic Hollywood.
Yeah, I mean, I tried to see if that happens in any of the later books. I mean, I haven't read them.
I hate, I don't know if that's true. Yeah, I haven't read him either. Again, he might be a knight in the past few books. You never know.
I think they said knights he was a priest. They said he was a priest.
No, but I'm saying a knight could be a priest. Maybe it could happen. You know, I mean, it could be a warrior priest. That's based on my Dungeons & Dragons background. I don't know. But that or Knight Templar. That being said, I kind of hope they were never lovers in the book series. I thought that was really kind of misogynistic. You know, it's like... He's a scorned man now, or she's a scorned woman, yeah. And that helps motivate. I did not like that element of it. It kind of annoyed
me. It's like kind of another classic Hollywood, like we gotta have that kind of tension in there.
Can't people just be evil without having to, you know, have this sexual tension between them? I don't know.
Without just having relationship issues?
it's like, well, my ex is a real witch. You know, come on, man. You know it's unnecessary.
Well, I think. And, well, those two, she was played by, what's her name? Blanking on her name.
Julianne Moore?
Julianne Moore, yes, Julianne Moore. And they were both in The Big Lebowski together,
Big Lebowski,
right?
Yeah.
So I think that's maybe why they had to, I don't know, ramp that up.
I kind
of
liked it.
They made them, I thought Julianne Moore was great in the movie, too. I'm a big fan of her all day.
She's a good actress.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. yeah, she is. It wasn't that bad of a movie, to be honest. It was pretty good.
Acting is decent. The another thing they did, which was I don't think it happened in the book, was in the book one of the witches sort of has like a sidekick who doesn't really have that big of a role, and is just kind of this menacing guy they call Tusk, who's got, I guess, teeth issues, and he's a big brute. And he's, I think in the book, he's knocked off at some point, I believe. But in the movie, he sort of replaces the Spook's Bogart, and he is like the Spook's, like, right-hand man. He's like the silent ogre-looking, like, guy who is just running around with them at their disposal.
Yeah, he's kind of like the squire of the Spook. He's just sort of like a reliable go-getter, you know, or gopher, you would say.
I thought it was interesting that they did that. I didn't understand why they... needed to, except that it just added to the fantasy aspect to have this like monstrous looking guy be part of their team.
Right.
I mean, I guess I kind of enjoyed that.
I did, you know, it'd be better if I got nothing to add. I mean, the Bogart was kind of indescribable from my readings in the book. So I'm just kind of glad that they made this character a little bit more concrete and put a little bit more character into him.
Well, in the movie they made a Bogart, it was this huge monster, like kind of troll thing.
Yeah, I mean, I just can't picture a huge monster troll thing making eggs and bacon for breakfast in the guy's house. Okay. So I'm just glad that they, you know, had Tusk there. I just couldn't imagine it.
There's some tension in the book about that. Like, I thought those. God.
I mean, another thing that I picked up on was that the witch, Mother Malkin, had all these evil cohorts, her minions that were under her, and there was like, I don't know, like a half dozen of them, and it was like almost like watching a scene out of like a Mortal Kombat movie or like a comic book, where it was like, you know, each one had their little aspect about them. They were very like comic book esque. They each had their own like ability and stuff like that, and she sends them off kind of one by one to go in and get the Spook. And I don't know, I kind of didn't like that, because it's just like it felt like those people were just being created just so that the Spook and the apprentice could just knock them out. And I don't know that they had a lot of depth to them. They didn't give them a lot of depth. Well, I don't know how you guys felt about that. Like the assassin and the other cohort.
It felt like a convention. Yeah, I agree with your assessment. I mean, it was. Yeah, it's like from the Nightfall comic book series of Batman, Bane. Yeah. To be honest.
Yeah, all of the other kind of evildoers in the movie, they might have popped up in other books. So maybe there were some subtleties in the movie that sort of played off of those characters from the books. But I just didn't know, you know. So I saw them more as like a one-dimensional characters, and they might have had subtleties added in the movie that sort of made you go, ah, yeah, that's the one character in the third book.
I didn't get that. I don't know. It just seemed like they were just, like you said, one-dimensional. They just created them so that we can have some people to take out before we go to Mother Malkin.
So we can have some, you know, cannon fodder and entertainment in the movie, right?
Yeah. All right. I don't know if there's anything else to add. Well, everyone, why don't we just give our ratings for it, since we're doing that now. I gave this book 3 stars. Wilk?
Solid 3 stars, yeah.
Yeah.
If I was a kid, probably 4.5.
Right. You're right. Rick? Exactly. 3.5. I could give the book 4. The movie gets 3 stars. worthwhile at least to rent off Netflix or whatever.
Yeah, I definitely think this is a good, it's a solid 3 stars for me, and I definitely recommend this book, and I would read more in this series. It was very enjoyable. All right, so that'll conclude this episode. Stay tuned next month when we review the book Divergent by Veronica Roth and the film Divergent, directed by Neil Berger and starring Ashley Judd. So we want to invite anyone to who's listening, if there is anyone, to write reviews on iTunes and like our Facebook page, follow us on Twitter. You can also check out our podcast on YouTube if that's more convenient to you now. And we appreciate that. So with that, we'll say goodbye to everyone. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Till next time.
For more information on the topics discussed in this episode, or to read our show notes and find us on social media, visit nodeodorant.com. For more information on Ryan Sean O'Reilly and his various works of fiction, visit RyanSeanO'Reilly.com. For more information on David Wilkinson, visit DryCracker.com. For more information on Richard Mell, check out his profile at Goodreads.com. The theme music for this podcast was written by John Doyle from the band I Decline. You can visit him at i-decline.com. Voiceover for this podcast was provided by me, Margaret O'Reilly. Well, that concludes our episode. We hope you've learned a lot. Again, thanks for listening to our show. And always, always remember, there is no deodorant in outer space.
I wish I had read this book 25 years ago, but it wasn't written then. It was all right, I guess. It's written for a younger audience, but it was interesting nonetheless. And it had occultism, Satanism, which is
okay. Rick, we can go to you unless I think you're getting coffee.
And I've shared many people's sisters in erotic moments throughout my life. And,
what?
Their mothers, once a grandma.
Hey, that's PG.
I mean, I've been with many, many women in many different contexts. Many, probably. I mean, two or sometimes three at a time. And I no, edit that out. Sorry. Yeah,
that will be edited out.
Okay. I just sniffed. Sorry. What was the question?
Well, he has this kind of standoff relationship with him. I don't know. Wilk, are you listening to something else?
I'm sending you guys a link to that Clint Eastwood line.
Oh, yeah. Maybe you could wait on that. But
probably, yeah.
Rick, what did you think about the relationship with the brother?